hope we find in here? Is it meant to stay in here? The grace we receive in here, the victory we proclaim in here, the revival that begins in here, is it meant to stay in here? Our faith is made for movement. Our testimony is designed to be told. This place with these people, this is the church. And what we do in here can change the world out there. We celebrate freedom in here so we can carry freedom out there. We pray for healing in here so we can bring healing out there. We tell the stories of God's goodness, God's peace, and God's love in here so we can be the story of God's goodness, God's peace, and God's love out there. This is no ordinary place. This is the body of Christ, a chosen people with a holy purpose, brought to life by Jesus and sent out by Jesus. We gather here, we confess here, we worship here, because what we do in here can change the world out there.
For worship today. I am a little light on announcements this morning, but I would like to highlight just a few things from your bulletins. Keep in mind that it is World Hunger Month this month, and for the month of October, we are collecting non-perishable food for our blessing box out front. You can leave any donations you might have for that in a basket right back here by the church entrance. Our safety team is meeting tomorrow evening. If you're on the safety team, please try to make that. And Joanne, you have an announcement this morning?
Just a quick announcement. Still working on the shoe boxes. We will have another day when we will pack, and I'll let you know as soon as we figure out what works for most people. In the meantime, pray for those children that will receive those boxes and their families, and all the hands that touch them. There are some examples in the window of some that we've done. We will eventually bring all those out here after the orchestra plays one Sunday. There's a great book in the library that you can see Judy if you want to read about how it all got started. It's just a great book. In the meantime, save your boxes, save shoe boxes. If you have shoe boxes all year long, just bring them. And I can wrap those. And if you feel led to give, you know, we need $4,250 for shipping. You know, that covers not just the shipping, but it gets a Bible in those kids' hands and trains all the people to teach those children about Jesus. So just keep praying for that mission.
Jessica, you have anything to say?
Just wanted to say that our LOL group and Fusion team group, we're over halfway done, and one of them were a little bit more than that, so they're wrapping up, but they're going really good. Please see the bulletin for volunteer needs. They are listed there specifically to give you a better idea. If you have questions, let me know. And please make an extra effort to pray and send some love to Will's friend, Jimmy. He received lungs. I don't know if it was one or both, but he's recovering from a lung transplant. So prayers that all that goes really well, and he does good with that.
Okay.
Just a reminder that our ladies' Bible study is tonight and tomorrow morning. Tuesday at the Table comes up. It'll come quickly, but here this week, Tuesday at the Table at Sansone's. We'd love to have any and all of you join us for that time of fellowship. And cheer baskets this week on Wednesday for those of you who can help assemble those and get those distributed. Scripture says this out of Psalm 115 in Ephesians chapter 2. It says, "But God, who is abundant in mercy, because of his great love that he had for us, made us alive with the Messiah, even though we were dead in trespasses. By grace we are saved. Not to us, Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory because of your faithful love and because of your truth." So let's worship as we consider this wonderful, merciful Savior.
Thank you.
Father, you promise us that where two or three are gathered, you are there in their midst. Lord, we welcome you amongst us today and celebrate the gift of life that you have given to each of us. We ask that you open our ears so that we may hear your voice. Open our minds so that we may receive your eternal wisdom. Open our spirits so that we may know your leading and guidance. And open our hearts so that we may receive your wonderful love. We ask all of this in the glorious name of Jesus. Amen.
I'll invite you to stand as we sing our opening hymns. All hail the power of Jesus' name, and his name is wonderful.
Requires of you
to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with our God.
Our offertory hymn is the first of the third stanzas of the Lily of the Valley, and I'll invite you to stand once again. Shares a beautiful praise song that reminds us that our Heavenly Father is the great King over all, and that His expression to us is amazing love.
Thank you.
We are just a few weeks away from a national election. Have y'all heard that there's going to be an election in a couple weeks?
Yes.
I think that we're now at the point where we're not so much afraid of who's going to win as we are of what's going to happen afterward, right? Elections used to be one of those things where you might stay up late on a Tuesday night to see who won. And it might be the person that you voted for, and it might be the person that you didn't vote for. But either way, you just kind of shrugged after that and just went on to bed and life went on. That's not so much the case anymore, is it? And one of the reasons why is that this country has a pretty serious anger problem, doesn't it? Social media rage, road rage, airline rage, everywhere you turn in both our public and our private lives, there's anger. And a lot of that anger stems from a kind of modern sense that we don't feel like we're in control of our lives anymore. A lot of it also stems from the fact that our nation was actually born out of anger. The British monarchy was taxing the colonists more and more without giving them a voice in government. And at a certain point, all of that anger in the colonies spilled over into rebellion. And that led to the creation of a new nation. And that new nation became, at least for a few centuries, a light to the whole world. Which offers us an important point. Anger isn't always a bad thing. God is described many times in the Bible as being angry. He's angry at sin. He's angry when his people turn away from him. He's angry at the hypocrisy of those who say that they're his children but live like they aren't. God gets mad sometimes. And since God is perfect and God cannot sin, that means his anger cannot be morally wrong. Theologians call that sort of anger righteous indignation. That's also the anger, by the way, that God calls us to have when we're confronted by things like injustice and the sufferings of the innocent. That kind of anger is necessary in a fallen world. It's positive anger because that's the sort of anger that leads to change, whether people are changing themselves or their society or even their government. But we're not going to talk about that good kind of anger this morning. We're going to talk about the bad kind, the sinful kind, the kind that we see almost everywhere these days, including inside our own hearts. As a Christian, You have to learn how to deal with your anger in a healthy way. Because when you don't, that anger is going to lead you straight into sinful behavior that hurts your relationship with God and your witness to other people. When we think of someone who has anger issues, we tend to picture somebody who's always yelling and screaming, right? Red face, and they're waving their arms all around. They're like a walking time bomb, aren't they? And they're always one tick away from just exploding. That's not always the case, though. Some of the angriest people that I've known in my life were the ones who always seemed calm and cool on the outside. Venting your anger isn't always the healthiest thing, but keeping it locked up inside you is even worse, because it's not going to stay there forever. Sooner or later, it's going to erupt, often in ways that harm you, both spiritually and even physically. Anger causes your body to release stress hormones that weaken your immune system, and then that increases the chance of sickness. It actually destroys neurons in your brain, which prevents you from thinking clearly. Constantly losing your temper literally makes you dumb. It tightens your blood vessels, which in turn raises your blood pressure, and that causes heart disease and strokes. None of that sounds like the way Jesus wants you to be living your life, does it? The Apostle Paul understood more than most just how destructive anger can be. There was a time in his life when his rage toward the early church was so great that it just turned into hate. Acts 9:1 says that Paul breathed threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. Acts 8:3 says he was ravaging the church, and entering house after house, he dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. Paul's anger destroyed innocent lives and families. His anger ended lives and families. And to make it even worse, Paul justified all of his anger by telling himself that his hate was actually pleasing to God. Paul actually thought he was doing God's will. But then Paul encountered Jesus, didn't he? And Jesus changed him. Jesus cured Paul of his anger problem, and Jesus can do the same thing for you. Paul tells us how in the third chapter of his letter to the Colossians. Turn there with me now. Colossians chapter 3. This morning we're going to start with verse 8. Verse 8 says, "But now you must put them all away, anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth." Now I want you to skip down, starting in verse 14 through verse 16. "And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God." This is God's word. Look at what Paul says, back up in verse 8. All of those nouns that he mentions after the word anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk, those are actually all different kinds of anger, and they all have the same cause underneath. Wrath is actually the sort of anger that's just sudden, and it's just full of fire. It's what happens when you just lose control of yourself. Now, the Bible speaks out against wrath because it's the anger that tempts you to seek revenge against someone, to get even with somebody over something that they've done or something that you think they've done against you. Malice is actually the next step from that. It's the anger that causes you to physically hurt somebody. But in the Bible, malice is also seen as a kind of bitterness. It's not just an anger over something that's happening to you right now. It's an anger over something that happened in the past that you can't let go of. You keep reliving it over and over and over in your thoughts. And so that wound you have never gets the opportunity to heal. So malice can be violent, but it can also be a very kind of quiet anger that's every bit as destructive. So those first two kinds of anger, they can be called evils of the heart. They poison you from the inside. The next two, Paul mentions, can be called evils of the tongue. And the first of those is slander. Your translation might say blasphemy there. To slander somebody is to hurt their name or their reputation. When you call somebody stupid, when you call them useless, you are slandering them. You're demeaning somebody who was made in the image of God. And Paul is also warning against slander in Ephesians 4:29 when he refers to it as corrupting talk. He writes there, "Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as good for building up, as fits your occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear." In other words, folks, when it comes to the things that you say, just be nice. It really is as simple as that. Because just one bitter word, one sarcastic reference, one thing that you might mean as a joke, can hurt somebody every bit as much as a fist. And it can reveal just how much of an anger problem you really have deep inside. The other evil of the tongue that Paul lists in verse 8 is obscene talk. Now, we all know what that means, don't we? Here is the best definition of cussing that I have ever heard. You ready? It is the vain attempt of a feeble mind to express itself forcefully. The vain attempt of a feeble mind to express itself forcefully. In other words, people cuss because they don't have an adequate enough vocabulary to express what they're feeling. And have you noticed how much cussing people do these days? It is everywhere now, isn't it? The average American now speaks 80 to 90 cuss words a day. That is 5 an hour. Your speech is a window that looks straight into your character. Your words matter. And they have a whole lot more power than you realize. Remember, God created the universe not with a thought, not with a wave of his hand. He did it by speaking. That is how valuable words are to him. So choose yours wisely. Wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk. Those are the kinds of anger that you are tempted with every single day. They're all around you. But notice the first two words in verse 8. But now. But now what? Right? What is the reason Paul gives as to why you have to deal with your anger? The reason is because there was a time when you were lost, but now you have been saved. There was a time when you lived according to the spirit of this world, but now the Holy Spirit lives inside you. Once you were not a Christian, but now you are. And because of that, Paul says in verse 8 that you have to take that anger. You have to take all that wrath and malice and slander and obscene talk, and you have to put them all away. Now, that phrase in the Greek is a lot more forceful than it is in the English. In the Greek, it means to take off something and to just throw it away. It's like an old pair of shoes that you always wear, and they're worn out, and they're all filled with holes, and somebody gives you a new pair that fits perfectly, and it's never going to get dirty, and they're never going to wear out. You don't need those old shoes anymore, do you? So you just get rid of them. You throw them out. You've been given Christ. You don't need to act like the world does anymore. You need to act like him. You don't need to talk like everybody else. You should be talking like him. But you can't do that on your own, can you? And a lot of well-meaning Christians make this mistake all the time. They say, well, I have this sin in my life, and I know God hates it, so I got to fix it myself. I can't ask God to help me because it's all my fault. But then they find out they can't fix it. Not on their own, because it's not just a matter of stopping something. Solving your anger isn't as simple as just not getting angry anymore. You need to replace that anger with something else. If you take those old shoes off, but you don't put the new ones on, then you're just walking around barefoot, aren't you? And maybe you can do that for a little while. But sooner or later, you're going to step on a piece of gravel or a Lego or something, and you're going to realize that you got to put some shoes on. And if the only thing you have laying around is that old pair of shoes, guess what you're going to put on again? So it's not just enough to take off your anger. You have to take off your anger and put something better on. And Paul tells us what that something is down in verse 14. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Now, if you look up at verse 12, Paul says you have to replace your anger with kindness. You have to replace your wrath with humility. your malice with weakness, your slander with patience. But the one thing that ties all of those godly attitudes together and makes every act you do and every word you speak perfect and complete is love. And you cannot have the love of Christ in you if you don't love other people and show them that love. Prove that love. Because everywhere that the Bible speaks of love, it is never, ever a noun. Love is not a person, place, or thing in the Bible. The Bible always speaks of love as a verb. It's an action. Love is something that you do. Jesus doesn't just say he loves you. He dies for you. He forgives your sins. Jesus says he loves you, and then he shows you that love, because showing it is proof of what he says. If somebody says, I love you, but never does anything to show you that love, you're always going to have the question in the back of your mind whether they really love you at all. Say and do. You have to have both. Jesus says, I don't want you to just say you love me. I want you to show it. And the best way to show that you love me is to treat people the way that I did. But that's not as easy as it sounds, is it? Let's be honest, there are some people who are just really hard to love. There are some people who just push your buttons all the time. So how do you handle them? How are you supposed to love others like Jesus said if some of those people are just people who always just make you mad? The answer to that comes in realizing that the love Jesus says you're supposed to have for others doesn't depend on what kind of person they are at all. It all depends on Jesus' love for you. Because who are you? Who are you? Strip all the theological stuff away and be honest about the sort of person that you are. I love you all, but you're all kind of a mess, aren't you? And I am too. I am the biggest mess there is. We're always falling short, aren't we? We're always screwing up, always disappointing ourselves. But Jesus still loves you. And because Jesus loves you, you can love anyone else who falls short and screws up and is disappointing too. But there's only one way that's possible. And Paul tells us in verse 15, and let the peace of Christ rule your hearts, to which you were called in one body, and be thankful. You have to put off your anger. But remember, that's just half the job. The other half is putting on the peace of Christ. The peace that is offered to you as a Christian has two parts. There is the peace that Jesus gives you, and then there is the peace that Jesus is. The peace that Jesus gives you is found in John 14, 27. Jesus says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give it to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Now, I mentioned earlier that part of why so many people in this country are angry now is because they feel like they're not in control of their lives. We're all overwhelmed now with noise and information and news and opinions that are presented as facts, and it's all designed to make you panic. And you panic by thinking that the world's just spinning off its axis. Everything's spinning out of control, and you are not in control. That's actually a pretty good thing to feel, though. Because guess what? Most of your life really is filled with things that are out of your control. You can't control a lot of what happens to you. But you have two wonderful things working in your favor with that. One is that even though you can't control hardly anything, you can always control the way you react to those things. You can always control your reaction. The other is even better. You might not be in control of anything, but Jesus is in control of everything, isn't he? Amen? Jesus is in control. And Jesus loves you. And Jesus promises that he's never going to leave you. So you don't have to let your heart be troubled by rage and anger. And you don't have to be afraid, because Jesus gives you his peace. But he's careful to say that when he gives you his peace, it's not like the world gives you things. The world gives you things to worry about. The world gives you things that are never going to satisfy you. But Jesus takes those worries away, and he gives you things that you need more than anything else in this life. He gives you his love, and he gives you acceptance, and he gives you relationship. The world gives you things because it wants something from you. How many people are nice to you because they want something from you? You can never really be sure if anybody's being sincere, can you? Jesus is always being sincere. The world says it can give you peace. All you need is this thing. Or all you need is to look this way. Or all you need is to be this kind of person. But the peace that the world says it can give you is never, ever real. It doesn't take away your sin. And it doesn't make you right with God. Jesus says, I can do both of those things. And everything about me is true. And the reason Jesus can give you a peace like that is because Jesus actually is peace. Listen to Ephesians 2:14. For he himself, Jesus, is peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility. If you have Jesus, if his peace is in your heart, what else do you need? What better thing could this world give you than that? Because you already have everything that matters. If you have that peace, it doesn't matter who tries to ruin your day, because Christ has guaranteed your eternity. It doesn't matter who says something nasty to you, because Jesus says, you're so special to me that I died for you. It doesn't matter if somebody doesn't like you, because the King of the universe loves you and cherishes you. The peace that Jesus is and the peace that Jesus gives is hugely important to overcoming your anger. That's because having that peace sunk down deep into your heart changes the way you see the world. It changes the way you see your circumstances. It changes the way you see other people. That peace creates a joy that nothing can take away, which then creates a constant sense of thankfulness in your heart. Look at what Paul says at the end of verse 15. And be thankful. Here's the reason why being thankful is so important to dealing with your anger. And it's a simple one. It is impossible to be thankful and mad at the same time. When your mind is filled with all the good things Jesus has done for you, all the things he's forgiven, all the things he's given to you, all the things that he's given his word he will do for you, all of those things that used to set you off start shrinking. They just don't matter so much anymore. The big things that used to set you off become little things that might aggravate you, but now you can just brush them off. You can brush off that feeling of anger over something that somebody said or did, because you understand that you are every bit as broken as they are, and even more. You can brush off the anger over the thing that happened to you, because you understand that Jesus is in control of that thing and that he's going to work it for your good. That peace is all about changing what you're looking at. You're no longer looking at the world and what other people are doing and saying, which is always going to make you stressed, right? Always. Instead, you're looking at Jesus and what he did for you and what he says about you. And that is always going to make you thankful. Paul says in verse 15 that you have to let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts when you're dealing with other people. That's an amazing phrase. Rule in your hearts. It actually means, in the Greek, to be an umpire. You need to make the peace of Christ your umpire. Now, for those among us who are not sports-minded, an umpire is an official in a game or a match who enforces the rules. An umpire decides what is right and wrong. And most importantly, the umpire is the one who has the final word, right? What the umpire says goes. You can disagree with them. You can argue with them. Sometimes they can be wrong. And if you're watching the Yankees, sometimes they're wrong a lot. But what the umpire says goes, right? As a human being constantly fighting selfishness and ignorance and every kind of sin, it is vital, folks, that you have an umpire calling what's right and wrong in what you're thinking and feeling. That umpire for you is the peace of Christ. That's what's going to keep you calm. That's what's going to keep your words and your actions in God's will. But you first have to let that peace be your umpire. You have to go to Jesus and say, I want you to be Lord of my life, not me, because you're perfect and I'm not. You're wise, I'm not. I can't trust myself to know what is right and wrong all the time, but I can trust you. If you do that, you're going to see two things happen in your life. One is that you're going to be a better person. You're going to be the sort of person that people are drawn to. And the other is that all of a sudden, people and circumstances don't drive you crazy anymore. That's what Paul means when he says in verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Paul is describing a life that is transformed by Jesus. He's talking about a fruitful life. If you have that peace of Christ in your heart, and you let that peace be the umpire over what you think and say and do, then your life is going to reflect that. You're not going to get angry. You're going to be teaching people about God by the loving way that you treat them. You're not going to react with wrath. You're going to be doing everything by the wisdom of love. You're not going to feel malice. You're going to have a song in your soul. You're not going to slander or cuss because those things come from the heart and your heart is filled with the peace of Christ. You're not going to waste your time getting angry about things or about people because you're going to be too busy being thankful. That's what the Christian life looks like. It's not just sitting in here once a week and opening up your Bibles. It's walking out there in the world the rest of the week and opening your heart to loving everybody you meet. But let's be honest too, you know, even with all that peace of Christ filling your heart, you're still going to get mad sometimes. Because you're human, right? And being saved doesn't make you perfect. It just makes you forgiven. So here are three scriptures that show you three godly ways to deal with that anger whenever it flares up. All right, you ready? So first, whenever you feel like you're getting mad, restrain it. Listen to Proverbs 29:11. A fool gives full vent to his spirit, but a wise man quietly holds it back. Now, this verse is not telling you that the way to deal with your anger is just to shove it deep down. What this verse is saying is that the proper way to deal with your anger is to choose the best way to express it. A fool is somebody who gets mad and just loses their mind. A fool holds nothing back. A fool cusses and throws things and yells things that they're going to regret later when they calm down. But the wise person feels that same anger rise up in them, and then instead of launching into a tirade, they pause. They take a breath. Never underestimate the power of taking a breath before you say or do anything. Because that one little moment is often enough for the Holy Spirit to speak up and say, careful now. Are you sure this is the way to go about things? Right? Are you sure this is the best way to react to this? Or do you think that maybe it's a better idea to go about this another way? Restraining your anger is all about keeping it within limits. That's what this verse is telling us to do. It's all about remembering who you are. You are not like everybody else. You are an ambassador of God called to minister to a world that does not know him. That means you are called to reflect his character in everything that you do and say. As soon as you forget that, you harm your witness. And believe me, this world needs all the good witnesses it can get right now. So first, restrain your anger. Then second, you need to define your anger. Here is James 1, 19 and 20. Know this, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Remember, God gets mad too. But God's way of dealing with anger is to be slow to anger. That means when you restrain your anger and take a breath, stop for just a minute and ask yourself, why? Why exactly are you getting mad here? And this isn't an easy thing to do, and it takes a whole lot of practice. But when you get mad at somebody, think about them first. What was it that they said or did? And was it on purpose? Did they really mean it? Or are they just having a tough day? Is something going on in their lives? Did they not get any sleep the night before? Did they have an argument with their spouse? Or maybe they did or they said that thing without even realizing what they were doing. Maybe they didn't even mean it to come across that way at all. You see, there are 1,000 reasons why that person could have done or said what they did. When you pause for a moment and you think about what's happening, you'll often see that there's no reason for you to get worked up over this at all. because that person never intended to hurt you in that way. And if they never meant to hurt you, why get upset about it? And while you're trying to define what that person did and why, do the same thing for yourself. If you're in a constant state of anger and agitation, and you're always losing your cool, that is a good sign that there's something deeper going on in your heart. Asking Jesus to show you what that is becomes the most important thing you can do. And when you ask him that question, you might find out there's so much that you need to work on your own, in your own life, that you are not even going to bother with what other people are doing or saying. And then third, once you're restrained, and once you've defined your anger, you can release it. Here's Paul in Ephesians 4, 22 through 24. Put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and be renewed in the spirit of your minds. And put on the new self, created after the likeness of God, in true righteousness and holiness. In other words, take all that anger and malice and slander and obscene talk. Take it all off and throw it away. Because you don't need that old life anymore. Christ has given you a new life. All those things that used to bother you about other people don't need to bother you anymore. And a lot of the things that do bother you about other people are things that you should just let roll right off you. A lot of times the best and holiest thing you can say is, all right, whatever. And just move on. Don't let it get to you. Don't let it sink into your heart, because most people have no idea, again, how powerful their words are. That is why so many use their words so carelessly. But you are called to be somebody who understands the power of words. You can be somebody who's let the peace of Christ dwell in your heart. But you got to work on it every day. You have to ask the Holy Spirit for help every day. Take off those old shoes. Put on the new ones Jesus wants you to wear. And if you're ready to do that, I invite you down here as we sing our closing hymn. Let's pray. Father, we are so thankful to worship a God of immense patience and unfailing love. That's why our greatest command is to love you and love others. Help us to do both of those things. Help us to see you in everyone we meet and to be a light of Christ to those who don't know you. Teach us to love one another and understand one another. Help us to shed those old shoes of our old selves so that we may put on the new ones given to us by the resurrection of your Son. For it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
I'll invite you to stand, please, as we sing our final hymn, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian.
Thank you.
Now may the peace and the love of Christ equip us for every good work, for all holiness, for all gentleness and peace. Amen.